I will talk about the modeling of a recirculating aquaculture system. To introduce myself, my name is Kai Wagner. I made my Master of Science in Automation at the University of Applied Science in Saarbrücken. It's an engineering school, and we have a cooperation with the University of Rostock where I do my PhD. This is where I'm coming from. This was my master thesis, assembling some hardware and introducing industrial controllers to aquaculture to get aquaculture to the standards of automation that's already widely used. And this will look like this with the human-machine interface. You can interact with your systems, you can save your data, you have controllers to set your system. This is, for example, for the denitrification process. It's a bit more complicated. Yeah, so this is where I'm coming from, just so you know, and you may understand why I did the model the way I did it. When I started, we did it in this small facility, and I wasn't sure if it's a thing for me. I mean, in where I'm come from, everyone is going into automation and steel and cars. But then this happened, and this was a new technology, and I really enjoyed working on it. I'm not sure if you can see it. This is inside the tanks of the RAS in Völklingen. So you can see we have CBUS. No, this is Cprime. Yeah, this is Cprime. In my presentation, I will introduce you to the RAS system like we do it in Saarbrücken. I will talk about the metabolic pathways of the fish, so you know where the nutrients are coming from. I will introduce material balance. I will talk a bit about the aims I have with the model. And then I will have a big part where I just show you how I made it and what my ideas were. Why should we do aquaculture, first of all? I mean, there's a lot of other animals we can cultivate and eat for proteins. But if we do the aquaculture like we do it in Völkling, we surprisingly need really few water for growing fish instead of pork and beef and chicken. This may surprise a lot of people. I mean, if you have a flow through system, you will need obviously a lot of water, but we reduced our water exchange rate to 1%, so we need like little to no water for growing our fish. This is the system, like really simplified. We have a water treatment, one main pump, we have our tank with the stock, and the water gets polluted, goes up in the treatment, and from there fresh water goes back. The water remediation FR flow is way bigger than the water loss flow. That's the important thing about it. This is the system in detail. So we have four big RAS in one facility, and then we have water purification for every one of the RAS systems. There you can see the animals they cultivated. The Cprime, the sea bass, the Seriola lalandi, yellowtail, kingfish, and the sturgeon. This is the look to one of the basins. This was, yeah, this is the sturgeon, just laying around on the ground, lazy bastards. you can see this is the feeding, this is the aeration system, and behind the wall, this is the water purification. You can see it here. The water comes from the tank, goes through a drum screen. We have a foam fractation. We have a CO2 degassing, MBBR. We already talked about it, and we will model it again. I'm sorry, guys, I didn't know that the other are doing MBBR as well. This is in detail. So we have the tanks, the feeding robot, a drum filtration, a flotation, a degassing, nitrification, also a denitrification, and this is one like the part we want to replace with algae or maybe with plants. Then a second drum screen, and it goes back into the system. And inside the system, we have aeration with pure oxygen. Now I will just show you a bit about the experimental RAS we have in Saarbrücken from my university. the reason I'm doing this is I have some numbers crunched here in the corner, and this will also be the numbers that are present in the model, as I modeled not the big facility, but our small experimental bus. This is the production basin with the fish. We had a basin of 6 cubic meter, a salinity of 15 to 30 PSU. We could just change it as we wished. We tried to stay between 20 and 25 degrees. We had a pH of 7.5 to 8. This is, if you not know it, it's oxygen reduction potential. It's 200 millivolt roundabout our system. It's important because we use ozone. If you use too much ozone, it will rise and it can be dangerous for the fish. Our oxygen had been above 90% saturation at all times in the fish tank. And we had a density of roughly 40 kilogram per cubic meter. Our flow, just a rule of thumbs for our technology, is about 3 times the basin volume per hour. At the tank, we had three systems. We added salt from a brine. We did add feed from an automated feeding system. And yeah, we did add oxygen through aeration. From the production basin, you can see it here, the water flows through 2 trunk screens with a mesh size of 40 micrometer. This is the flow rates of the trunk screens, and what is suspected to do is this, but just, you know, we never had like water like this, just to show you. So it takes out the big particles, but the small particles will stay in the system. Then we had sedimentation that got the flush water from the trunk screen. The feces sedimented and we pumped them out, and the water was restored and went further to the pump. Sump pump, same with the mainstream. Yeah, this is the, if you have to engineer such a system, you may need these calculations, but they're not present in the model, so I will not introduce them further. This is our pump sump. We did a lot of stuff there. We adjusted our pH. We add calcium or NOH to the system to get our pH up. We had heating or cooling if needed. We replenished water there, and we added brine. We also measured most of the parameters here, so we don't have sensors at the fish tank. There's a volume of around about 1,000 liter, and the flotation and denitrification was added to this. From there, the water goes up to the biofiltration. From there, we reduced ammonia and ammoniac to nitrate. Oh, there's a gap. Okay, we had a volume of about 1.5 cubic meter in the nitrification, and here we are like the numbers. You may remember these numbers from Simon. Then we have like this substratum surface. It looks like we had a better substratum. We had more surface on them per cubic meter, but nonetheless, like Rosten, this publication about embryo, they told there are no more than 60% of the surface is usable for the bacteria. And then you may remember from the drum screen that we still have like polluted water with really small particles. There comes the foam fractionator. He removed them, so he remove also color from the system, like you. If you have such a low replacement rate as we have, the water would get a bit yellow, and we added ozone there, so we had a high ORP, but the color was destroyed and the water in the system was clear. Yeah, this is like the design behind it. Microscreen drum filtration will get out everything above 13 microns, and the flotation will get out every particle beneath 30 microns. And this is important, he also flotates bacteria. You have to look, this is logarithmic, so if we have like 1 million bacteria, I'm not sure how it was calculated, like per gram in the influent water, the foam itself had 1 billion. So they had been heavily enriched, and from 1 billion in the flotate, like just 10 million were active, and everyone, the other bacteria was inactivated. So they are, we are not disinfecting it, but we're keeping the bacteria count low and we are disactivating them. And the last step, and this is maybe what we want to replace or work on replacing with Frederick's work, is the, oops, I'm not too fast, is the denitrification volume. Denitrification here, we use glucose or methanol to reduce the nitrate to N2. And we, then this is what was the work of a student here from Cork, so I added it. He worked with the denitrification and he found that we could reduce up to 2,000 grams per cubic meter of denitrification. It's just to know how efficient the denitrification is. If you remember at the nitrification, we had 0.3. So this could be 2,000 times smaller than a nitrification. And last but not least, we had also algae and plants introduced to the system where we let our nitrates to the plants and did grow them. We had Salicornia. You will have it on a handout. It's not what I'm working on. I just wanted to show. This is the rust, like an engineer may see it. We have a lot of sensors, temperature, level, this is ORP, salinity, pH, O2, we have flow is measured. And we have a lot of pumps, valves, ozone generators, compressors, and this is a mass flow controller for the aeration. So it's a lot of the technique behind it. If you make the leap to grow saltwater fish. And now I think we are getting to the part that's interesting for you guys. You want to have nitrate for your plants. And it all starts with the feed. It goes into our fish. This is the material flow we have there. They get oxygen, they get feed. They will excrete carbon dioxide. This is Oliver Körner, he wants this. You want the ammonia. And we will also have phases, and I have heard we have some guys working on biogas from the feces, so it's we have plenty of stuff for everyone. And from this we have dissolved organic matter, and this goes into the bacteria, and they will grow, and if you are not if we have no purification, this will happen. They will take on and compete with the fish, and we don't want this. They will also have ammonia and carbon dioxide and everything, but the fish will not grow, so we try to avoid this. This is a stoichiometric, just you can see we have like carbon hydrates, so we have CO2 from this, same from the lipids, and from the protein we obviously have our ammonia, which will later be nitrate in the system. And then we have a material flow, we also want to balance it, nothing is lost. So if we introduce feed in our system, our fish will grow from it, we will sell the fish, and we will also have slaughter loss. This can be made to create new feed. This we will sell. This can be used for the biogas, and that's where the plants come into the play. We can get a bit deeper into it. So what we did was we looked for the main ingredients of our feed, which is carbon, nitrogen, and phosphor. And we looked how is it saved in the fish, how much of these elements go into the feces, and how much will be in the water. So we have the biomass that increase with the carbon. We have the facial loss, this is feces, and this is ammonia in the water. This will be like the biological oxygen demand in the water. Then we have the nitrogen, same. Some some point that will be in the fish, like in their muscles. We have a facial loss in the particles, and this will be the ammonia, and then same with the phosphate. Some will be in the fish, some will be in the faces, and some will be phosphor in the water. I made this, I extra added this for Oliver, but he is not here, so there's also an energy boiling thing which he could use for the heat production from the rust, but it will not be in the... My motivation when I started was I went through the literature and there is almost nothing. Actually, this is the newest one I could find about automation in aquaculture, and as you can see, it's 70 years old, and I will just read it. The field of aquaculture has been considered by many of its practitioners to be as much of an art as a science. Success of aquaculture operation has been closely associated with the intuition of the farm manager rather than with understanding of the physiology, ecology, and behavior of the cultured species. So they have their fish and then they feed in like this belly feeling, like, they look hungry and they give them feed. And this is not how we want to do it in the future. So the automation has to step in. But to do this, the automation actually has to be smart. It has to know what's going on. It has to know the demand of the fish. It has to know how much flow we need and stuff like this. This can only be achieved with a model. So I wanted to develop knowledge for model-based automation by evaluating important parameters. What does this mean? With Simon's model, we already have seen that you need a bigger biofilter if you have more ton, but there are also other factors in it. So this is the formula for the tanks. I will introduce them later again. But what you will see is that we have biological oxygen demand in our water coming from the fish, and it has a negative effects on denitrification. So if this is the formula for denitrification, a really simple one, we would have like 1 through BOD. So the more we have BOD, the worse it gets. And with this, we have also the Q, that's the flow through. And then we have a flow through dependent nitrification rate because we have BOD in it. So there are interactions between previously like separated tasks. Same here, the nitrification, once again, is dependent on the oxygen. And the oxygen is dependent on the temperature and the salinity. So out of the blue, our nitrification is dependent on temperature and salinity, which was not the case beforehand. We'll just introduce what are the advantages of doing it in modeling instead of just like having experiments. The first of all, it's saving time. I mean, to create the entire model, I spent almost a year, but within 3 minutes, I can calculate an experiment that would need a year to be done. So after you have done it, you will save time. Yeah. The next thing, there's no danger to the cultivated animals. I think that's the most important. You can get to the borders. Like we can test out what happens if I increase the temperature to like 28 degrees, which would be dangerous for the animals. And you can just look what happens. Maybe you make it and you see it's not worth it. Like it's like 1% less energy input or whatever. And it's not worth risking the fish. But you would also see like, wow, it's working so well, we may like get close to this, like 26, 27. It's adaptable for different systems. I mean, after I've made it, I can, like, in a week, it will be ready for another system if you just adjust it. And as I have made it in MATLAB, I can test control strategies on it. MATLAB is like the best software for automation engineers. Then this is the system again, and this is the model. We see we have the red one includes everything. That's the system. It has all the filters and the tanks. And the black one, this is the fish. So we have feed input. The fish live in a basin, and at some point we remove them and sell them. And this, the same we have in the model. So I will introduce two models today. One is the system. We have our basins. We have concentrations of the nutrients. We can add limitations to ammonia, for example. We have mass transfers, and we have aeration. And we have also filters that have peak graduation rates. We have production rates in the filters. We have the mesh size, and we have the state of the filter. Is he in a good state? And the next one, we will model the fish, and we will start with that. When we have a fish model, when I started, the first thing you do is you want to grow the fish. So you have a model for the biomass and its growth, and you have to decide which one do I pick. There are plenty of models. Like, there are models that are depending on the feeding rate. So you put in how much feed you introduce to the system, and these models will tell you how much the fish are growing. You have models on maximum growth. So they did feed the fish to saturation and just looked how much are they growing if you have optimal conditions. We will have models on specific growth rate and FCR. And you also will need mortality if you're modeling big amounts of fish. This is just an example. This is from my professor, the model he uses. It's he has FCR curves and instantaneous growth rate and individual weight, and you name it. It's really complicated at that point. Then we have models on maximum growth. And these are the most important for us. And we have already evaluated them, like in this study made by us. We are actually above the growth rate in the model. And I just finished one growth experiment. Frederik had the data in his sheet. We had been 10% above the maximum growth rate. So it may not be the maximum growth rate. We did it better. So what I just said, I had the decision for the maximum growth rate. Why? We're doing fish farming commercially, so this is the logical way to go. The formula is looking like this. This is just, you can see it's always a day. If I have a D there, it's always one day. So it will tell you how much they grow in one day. I set the parameters to constant. I mean, A, B, and C are already set in the model, but I also decided to have the temperature. For now, it's set in stone on 23 degrees in the fish model. Why? The fish is not introduced to the system. So there's no, if you change the temperature in the system, the fish model will not know it. So I just say, okay, I will set it in stone for now. And we also added mortality. The next thing you have to do, now that we know how fast the fish is growing, how do we quantify the feed that we need? There are, once again, a lot of models, like the FCR I introduced earlier. You can, and I have done it, estimate the feed with the requirements for energy and protein the fish has. This is especially really important, as 36% of the cultivation costs in systems like we use come from the feed. So you want to use as little as possible and as much as needed to have the maximum growth. It's like you have to be really, really precise. And how is it done? There are two things, the two energies the fish needs. First of all, he needs energy for his metabolism. like if he's resting, and then he needs energy for his growth. And this is divided by DE is the digestible energy in the feed. And at the same time, he needs proteins for his metabolism and proteins for his growth. By the way, this is not a minus, and I just realized it's really unfortunate to have it in a mathematical calculations. It's E resting metabolism plus E growth, and P resting metabolism plus P growth, and once again divided by the digestible protein. The next thing I did, other than Simon, my model actually works with minutes, so we have 1,440 steps every day in the model. And for this, all the metabolic pathways and the mass balances beforehand had been on a daily basis, so we know they discrete, let's say, 100 grams of nitrate a day. But what do we do with this? So we need a model that tells us how much does they discrete at a certain time. And I have done this with models from Wurzburg and Ritchie. They introduced the gastric evacuation rate. It's basically just telling you if you feed them, they will get the feed into their system, and then they will discharge it in a timely pattern. I think this is a bit complicated for now, but one thing, this will be here you introduce the feed, and at like 20 hours, they have discreted everything of it. And I just needed the T95, so I just looked at what point they discreted like 95% of the feces. Why I've done this? Vic introduced a concept where he told you can actually model how your fish excrete feces and ammonia by simulating it with a PT2 system. You may have to Google it. I can't introduce it for you now. It's a bit too complicated, but it looks like this. At this point, we feed them, then the excretion rate rises and it shrinks afterwards. And this is like if you do the integral above it, it will look like this. And then again, I have the T95 and I did set it on the same value. This way I wanted to simulate how they excrete the ammonia and the feces into the water. And if you have several feedings, it will look like this. You will see it if you have the experiments with the model. In this part, I had 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 feedings. So it looks a bit bumpy, but it still works just fine. But just having assumptions isn't enough. You will also have to check the literature if whatever you're thinking is true. And I found this. I was really pleasant. This is from Robiana. You will see the ammonia will rise and then slowly go down. This is from Brett, really old again. He did fed them, and ammonia discretion rises and then it falls back. Schneller found like this. This is the feeding period of him. Ammonia will rise and then eventually go down again from the filters. And this is from Palestrani. Once again, they get fed. Ammonia discretion rises and then it falls down really smoothly. So it seems to be, I think I have made it right. At least I hope so. Next thing is I will have to create a waste matrix to multiply it with the evacuation signal. So we introduce the elements to the fish, and then we have a body composition of the fish that is a sink. So feed goes into the fish, they have their metabolism and the energy and moisture and lipid and ash and protein will enrich in the fish. Then I have calculations for the energy. Every energy that is not in the fish has to be used by metabolism. And Elliot gave some insights on how much oxygen they have when they have a certain amount of energy in their feed. And I can calculate the oxygen demand and the CO2 production by balancing the energy. And lastly, there is a digestibility and the leaching going on in the system described by Lupacz. And this is how it looks. We have the signal from the feedings, and we have the waste matrix. This is like we have facial loss and non-facial loss of all three particles. So we have six values, and we also have the O2 and CO2 production and reduction that is introduced to the system model. And now we start with the system model. You may remember our system. So we have the production basin. This is one part of the model. We have the drum screen. It's another part in the model. The pump sump, the nitrification, and the aeration. And what we don't have, as it would be too complicated today to have the entire system introduced, we will not look about the flotation. We will not look about the denitrification. I mean, we don't want it anyway here, so take it away. No sedimentation, no pH buffering, no salt. So it's really easy. So next thing is nitrification. And this is there it starts. How do I choose the model I want? There are plenty of models. I will introduce some of them. The easiest one, Simon always told us, it's like, okay, you have 1 gram, your biofilter will reduce 1 gram per square meter. That's like the easiest calculation you can have. And you can build a model with it. But you can go one step further. You can say, okay, that's fine, but I also know it's dependent on the concentration. If I have a low input concentration, my filter will not reduce as much, and if I have a high, my filter will maybe even go about this 1 gram from Simon and have a higher yield. And you can also make it more complicated and say, okay, but it's also dependent on the temperature. So we have different sets depending on which temperature we have and which concentration we have. Is this enough? It could be enough, but you could also say, I want more. So we have something like this. Same thing, it's a concentration. You can also add temperature on it. But you also have limitations on the O2 you have in the filter. So if the O2 is low, you will not go about 1.5. And this is like really dangerous. Like you design your filter with the number Simon gave you. And at some point, your fish are dying because you have low oxygen in your filter, and it will not work. So it may be beneficial to have a system like this. But then I thought, okay, that's already really good. But I don't know how much DO I have in my filter, as this one will not tell me how much DO my bacteria will consume. So we go one step further. From now on, this models are part of the active sludge model, often used by wastewater treatment. I guess we will hear about it at the area. I can just assume, maybe. We will have a lot of information in it, and you will see it in the model. I will have my metrics on the screen when we are playing around. But for some people, it's still not enough. You know, they always want more. So they can go even further and say, I want to know how is my biofilm looking. As you can see, if you cultivate it right, the surface will be much bigger. So it could be beneficial to use models like this. And some people are really crazy. They make it three-dimensional. And you have like something like this. But as you can see, it is 1,000 microns per 1,000 microns. So it's really, really small comparture. And calculating such a smaller comparture alone will need a lot of computation. So it's not suitable for me. I'm not sure what it's good for anyway, but some people do use it. And you can see, yeah, you can see it's increasing in complexity, but it's also increasing in what you can do with it. And this is the crux of simulating. you have to find your niche, and you have to know where you want to be. Apparently, I wanted to be here, so this is the model I will introduce. Then you have to choose a notation. If your model is getting big, you should have an idea how to call every part of it. The nitrification is also the most advanced filter I have in my simulation. So I did choose notation for the nitrification and adapted it for all the other filters, for the simpler ones. In general, you will see everything I will have marked with a X is particulate. Everything marked with a S is soluble. And then if we go further, we will have inorganic and organic compartures of both of them. Then we go even deeper, like we here in the biofilter, we will have anode that are these are the heterotrophic and these are the autotrophic bacteria and so forth. And if you want to model it, you will also have to structure it. So you will have to search for a structure that is suitable for you. I will just explain it really short. If you enter the biofilm model, we have a mass balance at the start. It's looking how much oxygen is getting in, how much nitrogen is getting in. Then I have the biofilm, and I will have to calculate the mass of the attached biofilm. I will have to calculate the thickness of the biofilm. I will have to calculate the concentrations of the different bacterial species. I will have to calculate how deep the substrates are going into the biofilm. And I have to decide, is it fully penetrated? If yes, it's really easy. Everything will be set on one. But if it's not, there's different cases that can happen. Like if I have too less oxygen will be depleted at a certain depth, and going deeper into the biofilm will not help me. There's no oxygen for the bacteria to reduce the nitrogen. And then I have to calculate the detachment and the production rates. And at the end, I will once again have to do a mass balance to introduce all the changes that happened while computing it. Same goes for the drum screen. The drum screen will be really easy in the model. It will just say everything above the mesh size is removed, everything beneath will go through. But you can also play around with the numbers. The literature isn't this sophisticated if it comes to drum screens. I can just show you. Some say that there are particles. I will go to the mesh size I have. This one says, okay, you only have 10% of particles that are smaller than your mesh size. But this one tells me there are 50% that are smaller than my mesh size. Same goes here. Everyone is telling you other stuff, so you actually have to, I will call it a sophisticated guess. You can play around with the numbers, see what's happening. And last but not least, I will have to the basins. We have the fish tank and the sump. We will have a flow through, this is the Q, and we have a concentration that is coming to the system. In the system, we will have this calculation for every value. It's just how fast is it changing its flow through with the concentration going in minus the concentration with the flow going out of the system plus concentration that is added to the system, for example, by aeration, and minus concentration that is lost, maybe through water loss. And I have to make one assumption. All my basins are meant to be a CSTR system, so it's a continuously steered tank reactor. You will not find a steerer anywhere, but this is the assumption you have to make it somewhat simple. If you have a really long basin and you have flow through at the start, you will have a high concentration at the start and a low concentration of oxygen when it's leaving. But our basin, and the lot of fish that we have that are going in circles, I say the concentration of oxygen at the start of the system is the same than I have at the end.